Ham Radio Now, episode 144, ARISS to the Max, part 4, a SAREX contact from 1992. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. Ham Radio in Space began in 1961 with the Oscar 1 satellite. That was the one that just beaconed high, did it in Morse code. This is an AMSAT picture of Lance, I think it's Jenner, could be Ginner, K6GSJ. He's holding the actual flight model or version of the Oscar 1 satellite. And this is an AMSAT picture of Lance building Oscar 1 in his basement. And look in the background at all the Heathkit stuff on his bench. That's a Seneca on the left for 6 and 2 meters. And I think that's an Apache and Mohawk transmitter and receiver for HF. Do you know what frequency Oscar 1 operated on? It wasn't easy to find. OM3 KTR's website listed it as 144.983 megahertz. And an AMSAT history just said it was 145.0. Well, you know how radio calibration was back in those days. Not as fine-tuned as it was today. They also said that the speed of the high, the did-did-did-did-did, was controlled by the temperature sensor, by a temperature sensor inside the spacecraft. So this was some very basic telemetry. And here's what it sounded like. I got the audio from this AMSAT webpage. It says on the webpage that at normal speed of the audio playback, it's too fast to copy. But if you listen carefully, it is fast, but I think you can pick it out pretty well if you've got good ears. But if it is too fast, they provide this slower version. That recording was made by Roy Welch, W0SL. He was a W5SLL at the time. He was using a less than optimum antenna. It says it was a designed for around 108 megahertz for other satellites. And the satellite, the Oscar 1, was only running 140 milliwatts, so almost no power at all. It was in orbit for 22 days and made 312 orbits, trips around the Earth. First ham radio operated by a human in space was in 1983 when Owen Garriott, W5LFL, took a handy-talkie up on shuttle mission STS-9.
This was has a 5-watt output and is connected via a cable here that we can see running up to an overhead window.
Echo India Zero, Radio Tango Sierra. This is the headquarters station of the Irish Radio Transmitters Society.
Yes, Irish station. This is W5 Lima Foxtrot Lima in the spacecraft Columbia. I just came on the air and heard you calling me. I just came on the air at this moment and W5 Lima Foxtrot Lima in the spacecraft Columbia. I heard your call right off. And I'll have it on my tape recorder and get it reported properly when I get back on the ground. So this is W5 Lima Foxtrot Lima, spacecraft Columbia, calling CQ, Ireland, Great Britain and Europe.
I'm here with Owen Garriott, W5LFL. Owen, what's your claim to fame?
Well, it probably depends on who you ask, but I did happen to be able to take the first amateur radio transceiver into space back in 1983 on Space Lab 1.
Again, the first SAREX operation was in 1990, and I'm not sure if this list on the ARL website is complete, but it looks as if the one that we did in 1992, that was on STS-47, might have been just the fifth SAREX mission. My notes from back then indicate that we, the Raleigh Amateur Radio Society, were competing with 100 other schools for those few opportunities. And I need to give a ton of credit to Ken Edwards and for ZBB. Ken took the project for the club, did all the legwork to get the schedule, directed the whole project. And not just like the Onslow County Club, Ken had a team of talented and scared-to-death hams who were helping him out. But it really takes dedicated leadership. It takes the guy to make this happen. Our contact date was Wednesday, September 16th, 1992 at 9:34 a.m. But again, like the hams in Onslow and all the other hams who set up these school contacts, we did a lot of preparation. Unlike the Onslow group, we only did one dry run. And I'm going to show you a short video of that dry run. Back in 1992, there was no public internet, certainly no streaming video. We had an ambitious setup. We had just 4 students. and they were going to be located at four different schools scattered around the county. We're going to link their audio to the uplink station, and you'll see that on the video, using our UHF repeater. Now, I actually made this video to be shown at each of those four schools to let the students there see what the whole operation looked like, because they couldn't see anything else except the one student and their little radio. So this was our dry run.
We have main engine start. 2, 1, solid rocket ignition, and liftoff. Liftoff of Endeavour on America's 50th space shuttle flight.
When the space shuttle Endeavour lifted off from the Kennedy Space Center in Florida last Saturday, it carried with it dozens of scientific experiments. Today, we're going to participate in one of them. It's called SAREX, the Space Shuttle Amateur Radio Experiment.
160 nautical mile orbit.
SAREX is a communications experiment. On board Endeavour is a special amateur radio station. It's actually a modified walkie-talkie, the kind of radio you might see a policeman carry. But it's set up to operate on an amateur radio frequency. Two of the shuttle astronauts, mission specialist Dr. Jay Abt and payload specialist Dr. Minoru Morhi, are licensed amateur radio operators, and they'll be using this special radio to talk to us here in the Raleigh area. Earlier this summer, they practiced using the SAREX radio while the shuttle was parked at the Kennedy Space Center.
Hey, well, that's great. Well, thanks for coming back to us. We were testing something for the shuttle amateur radio experiment, and you were just terrific to come back to us.
The Raleigh Amateur Radio Society has set up temporary amateur stations at Cary High School, East Wake Middle School, and Effie Green Elementary School. These stations will be linked by radio to two Earth stations located in North Raleigh. The Earth stations are really just the home stations of Rob Oates and Carl Ebhardt. Rob and Carl have antenna systems designed to let them communicate with the amateur radio satellites, and that makes them perfect for helping us talk to the shuttle. We'll use one of the Earth stations to relay our signals, and the other will be a backup in case of technical trouble. We'll be using all this equipment to let three students, senior Kevin Carter at Cary, seventh grader Nicole Farrell at East Wake, and third grader Chris Winstead at Effie Green, each ask the astronauts a question. After each question, we'll hear the answer live from space. This SAREX experiment is a complex operation, and it required some practice. Everything must be done quickly. The shuttle will only be in radio range for about 4 minutes. So last Saturday, just after the shuttle lifted off, we set up all our equipment, got everyone in position, and tried a few practice runs. Since today, you'll be able to hear the entire experiment, but you won't be able to see all of it, we're going to show you what the practice run looked like. Now, the actual space shuttle wasn't involved in our practice session, so the part of the astronaut was played by amateur radio operator Bill Lyon, talking on his own handheld radio. If everything goes right, in a few minutes, our real conversation should sound something like this.
Kilo Delta 4, Lima, Lima, Quebec. This is Kilo Mike 4, Oscar Hotel. Over.
Good morning, Endeavour, from Raleigh, North Carolina. Cary High School, send the first question. Over.
My name is Kevin Carter. I'm a senior from Cary High School. And how long have you been a ham radio operator, and how has it enhanced your career?
Well, Kevin, I've been in ham radio for about 10 years now. The knowledge gained in my early years in amateur radio has played a very important role in getting me where I am today. Over.
My name is Nicole Furl. I'm a seventh grader at East Wake Middle School. What do you do in case of a medical emergency while you're in orbit? Over.
Well, Nicole, the medical emergencies are very rare on a shuttle mission. We're extremely careful in everything we do. We have very strict safety rules, and we make sure we follow them closely. Over.
My name is Chris Winstead.
I'm a third grader at Effie Green Elementary School. How far away from Earth will the shuttle be in 8 minutes from now? Over.
Right now, the space shuttle is hundreds of miles southwest of Raleigh, but it's moving toward us very quickly. In a few minutes, it'll appear over the horizon. No, you won't be able to see it, but that also means it will be in radio range of our amateur radio Earth stations. And that's when our part of the SAREX experiment will begin.
Do you like how slowly the computer is drawing the tracking program image? Gotta love 1992. All right, here's the video of the actual contact and the failure that preceded it. Our scheduled contact was with mission specialist Dr. J. Apt, N5QWL. When that went awry, which you'll see, our second try was with the pilot, Kurt Brown. And Kurt's not a ham, so I guess Jay was busy on another project the second day. They probably picked Kurt because we were in North Carolina and he was a North Carolina native. We call ourselves Tar Heels. You look it up. The video starts just like the dry run, because video editing is hard, especially back then, but it pretty quickly gets to the new stuff. So let's take a look.
We have main engine start. 2, 1, solid rocket ignition, and liftoff. Liftoff of Endeavour on America's 50th space shuttle flight.
When the space shuttle Endeavour lifted off from the Kennedy Space Center in Florida last month, it carried with it dozens of scientific experiments. One of them gave a group of Wake County students a rare experience, the chance to talk live to an astronaut in space. The experiment is called SAREX, the Shuttle Amateur Radio Experiment.
Roll maneuvers complete aboard Endeavour. The orbiter's now in a heads-down position on course for a 57-degree, 160-nautical-mile orbit.
SAREX is a communications experiment. On board Endeavour is a special amateur radio station. It's actually a modified walkie-talkie, the kind you might see a policeman carry. But it's set up to operate on an amateur radio frequency. Two of the Endeavour astronauts, mission specialist Dr. J. Apt and payload specialist Dr. Minoru Mori, are licensed amateur radio operators. And they use this special radio to talk to ham radio operators around the globe. On September 16th, the Raleigh Amateur Radio Society was scheduled to contact the shuttle. We set up temporary amateur stations at Cary High School, East Wake Middle School, Effie Green Elementary School, and West Millbrook Middle School. These stations were linked by radio to two Earth stations located in North Raleigh. The Earth stations are really just the home stations of Rob Oates and Carl Ebhardt. Rob and Carl have antenna systems designed to let them communicate with the amateur radio satellites, and that makes them perfect for communicating with the shuttle as well. Four students, one at each school, were chosen to talk to the astronauts. The students were to ask questions and receive a live reply. The questions were prepared in advance, and everything had to go quickly because the shuttle would be in communications range for only a few minutes. The whole operation was broadcast live by WLFL, Fox 22 Television.
Good morning, I'm David Allen, and in just a few minutes, we will be taking you live to Cary High School. Students there are preparing for an experience of a lifetime. With the help of the Raleigh Amateur Radio Society, students will be making contact with the shuttle Endeavour.
Also talking at 9:32 a.m., the shuttle was supposed to appear over the radio horizon.
It should be coming up here any minute. We can see on our screen above the SDS Plus tracking program.
N5QWL, here is KM4OH. Over. N5QWL. Here is KM4OH.
But something went wrong. For several tense minutes, SAREX control station Rob Oates called to the shuttle, but received no reply.
N5QWL. Here is KM4OH. Over.
Suddenly, astronaut J. Abb's voice boomed in.
Kilo Mike 4 Oscar Hotel, Kilo Mike 4 Oscar Hotel, this is Endeavour, Colin.
Hey, all right!
N5QWL.
From Kilo Mike 4 Oscar Hotel.
He was calling us, but apparently couldn't hear our response.
WL, KM4OH.
Just before the shuttle sped out of range, we did establish contact, and the students attempted to ask their questions, but it was too late.
Question is, how long have you been a ham radio operator, and how has it enhanced your career? Over.
The students and the ham radio operators were disappointed and frustrated. but NASA offered us a second opportunity the next day. This time, they asked us to use a simpler communication system. So we brought the students to one of our Earth stations, the ham station at the home of Carl Ebhardt. Once again, the shuttle came into range.
There he is.
Rob called.
N5, QWL, here is KM408, over.
And this time, we made contact. And what a contact.
Yeah, good morning, Endeavour. Your signal is still weak here. Still weak, please. Try another transmission. Over.
We copy you a straight radar. We've got a better answer to you here. Just over the horizon, and should be a better answer to you.
Go ahead.
My name is Kevin Carter. I'm a senior from Cary High School, and my call sign is KD4ISB. The question is, how long have you been a ham radio operator, and how has it enhanced your career?
At first, as shuttle pilot Kirk Brown answered Kevin Carter's question, his voice was lost in noise. But soon it sounded like he was in the room with us, and the students made their historic contact.
He was saying he's not a ham radio operator. Nicole, pull up close.
My name is Nicole Furl. I'm a seventh grader at East Wake Middle School. What do you do in case of a medical emergency while you're in orbit?
Over.
Over.
I'm a third grader at F.U. Green Elementary School. How far away from Earth will the shuttle be in 8 minutes from now? Over.
Well, we will be 160 miles above the Earth. Basically the same. We're in a circular orbit around the Earth, so it's 163 miles all the time. And right now we're just passing over central Kansas.
My name is Nicola Scaraglino. I'm a seventh grade student at West Millbrook Middle School. My question is, what energy source powers the Endeavour?
Well, Nicole, that's a good question also. What we have on board is cryogenic oxygen and hydrogen, and that just means it's really cold, so we can store a lot of it. It's liquid. And we take that and run it through a thing called a fuel cell, where we combine hydrogen and oxygen and produce water and electricity. And that's where we get the electrical power to run all the computers and all the lights and all the other instrumentation aboard Endeavour.
This is Kevin Carter, KD4ISB. Our second question is, how are the frog experiments going?
I'm an orbiter crew member, and I've been trying to keep up to date with what's going on in the space lab. If we have fertilized some eggs, and they have developed into tadpoles, and they're growing at a really well, and quite a few of them have developed into a good-sized tadpoles.
This is Nicole, and my second question is, how many sunrises and sunsets do you see each day? Over.
And Nicole, as you probably know, we since we're orbiting the Earth at a very, very fast speed, we see two sunrises and two sunsets every orbit that we go around. Since it takes about an hour and a half to go around, we see a sunrise and then a sunset, another sunrise and another sunset.
This is Chris Hornstead. How do you take a bath or a shower in space? Over.
Unfortunately, we don't have any showers, so we can't do that. What we do have, though, is we have washcloths and towels, just like you do on Earth, and we use a solution that's that you don't really have to wash off. You put it on your wash rag, and then you just rub it over your body to basically bathe like you're out camping, and that's the way we do it.
This is Nicole from West Millbrook. Where did you get the name Endeavour from?
Nicole, as you may know, it was a few years ago when we were building the Endeavour. We had a contest. The president asked for all the students across the United States to come up with a name for a new orbiter, and a group of school kids from Louisiana, I think, was where who won the contest, and they came up with the name Endeavour. It's an old British sailing ship that is still around today.
Third question from Kerry High School is, what is your favorite view from the space shuttle on Earth to look at?
There are so many of those that I'm not sure I can give you my most favorite, but one of them is passing over North Carolina, looking at the Outer Banks and the coastline, and trying to find my hometown. And the second one is probably the sunrises and sunsets. They're tremendously beautiful. As the sun goes down through the atmosphere, you get all the different colors, and as it comes up through the atmosphere, you get all the different colors. And another thing that we're able to see on this mission that a lot of shuttle missions aren't able to see is the aurora down at the southern pole, and it is very spectacular. There's nothing, no way you could explain that. It's just a bunch of lights dancing around, and it's really beautiful.
This is Nicole. What do you do in your spare time while you're in space?
Nicole, I wish we had more spare time, but actually since it costs so much money and it takes so much work to get the orbiter up here, we spend most of our time working. There's very little spare time. If we're not actually running an experiment or taking scientific data, we're usually looking outside the windows taking pictures of the Earth, which we use for geography analysis and different plant life analysis on the Earth.
This is Chris Winstead. How is it like to fly the Endeavour? Over.
Well, so far I can't tell you because this is my first trip up in space, and the commander will do the flying when we land, but the ride from launch up to orbit was unbelievable. It was a very impressive ride, so I'm hoping to see how the orbiter flies in about a couple of days here when we go ahead and land out at Kennedy Space Center.
This is Nicole. What made you decide to become an astronaut?
Well, Nicole, I have always liked flying, and I don't know if you know anything about my background, but I wound up going into the Air Force and flying fighter-type aircraft for a long time, and I just wanted to keep flying more and more complicated machines, and I think the orbiter's about as complicated as you can get, so I just like flying, and that's what I like doing.
This is Kevin Carter, KD4ISB. If you plan on going on another space shuttle flight, would you mind talking to us again?
Well, we'd love to do that. I plan definitely on going on another mission if NASA sees it straight. If SAREX is, which is our amateur radio experiment, if it benefits it from my plan, I'd love to do that. That'd be great.
This is Nicole. This is Nicole. Do you like North Carolina or North Carolina State?
That's a very sensitive subject.
This is Chris Winstead. Where is your home in North Carolina?
Thanks a lot for talking to me, and y'all have a good time, and I'll see you when we get back down.
Thanks very much, Endeavour. We sure appreciate your help. N5QWL, KM408. Tally-ho.
Now, with WTBD 11 News, Larry Stogner. Miriam Thomas, this is WTBD 11 News at 6.
Boy, has this been a once-in-a-lifetime kind of day for four Wake County school kids. They held a conversation that was literally out of this world.
The four students talked to the captain of the space shuttle Endeavour as it circled the Earth. It was a project of the Raleigh Amateur Radio Society. WTBD's Dave Bolick listened in.
It seemed like Nicole Farrell sat in that chair at East Wake Middle School forever yesterday morning.
Well, first of all, I got sleepy, and and I got disappointed because we didn't talk to the astronauts yesterday.
Nicole was one of four Wake County students chosen to talk to the space shuttle Endeavour as it sailed 163 miles overhead yesterday. They tried to get through, but they didn't. The space shuttle goes around the Earth about every hour and a half. Even though they failed to make contact yesterday, they did have another chance today.
Yeah, good morning, Endeavour. Your signal
is... Today, everything worked like a charm. Nicole got to ask her question.
What do you do in case of a medical emergency while you're in orbit?
If it was really, really serious, we'd go ahead and land and get up to a hospital as soon as we could. Over.
She and the other students got more than they bargained for. They talked to Captain Curtis Brown, who's from Elizabethtown near Wilmington, for about 10 minutes, and they asked about his favorite view from space.
Sitting over North Carolina, looking at the Outer Banks and the coastline, and trying to find my hometown.
What energy source powers the Endeavor?
Well, Nicole, that's a good question also. What we have on board is cryogenic oxygen and hydrogen.
When it was over, the students and their parents and their teachers were delighted they had made contact.
I was really scared that we wouldn't, but then as soon as they replied, I was just really happy. I'm still shaking.
Oh, Captain Brown, the North Carolina native, managed to duck the big question of the day. It came from Nicole.
Do you like North Carolina or North Carolina State?
The question was covered as static as Endeavor mercifully cruised out of radio range. Dave Bullock, WTVD 11 News, Raleigh.
Guess we'll never know.
We may never know. It's still ahead on WTVD 11.
Once in a lifetime. Or have I heard that before? It's still hard not to choke up. So why did the first contact fail? Well, we don't know. There are two theories. First, Jay Apt, he was on the shuttle, might have been listening to the wrong uplink frequency. But if that's what happened, NASA never fessed up to it. So theory two, well, remember we were using that complex four-school setup with a repeater linking everybody to the uplink station? That station had a homebrew interface. It manually patched the repeater into the uplink transmitter. And when NASA gave us our second chance, they wanted us to do it simpler. So that gives me a clue that they didn't think it was their problem. So maybe, just maybe, our uplink station had a switch in the wrong position. There were a bunch of switches on there. And we knew we were transmitting, but it could be just a dead carrier. My notes tell me that we did make one clear mistake. We had watt meters, and you know, they guaranteed we had a signal going up. But we didn't have anybody listening with their ears and a speaker or headphones or something to the uplink frequency to make sure that the signal was good and had audio on it. So we don't know. We'll never know. Well, we weren't the only failure. It's not common, but they do happen. And in fact, on a recent Ham Nation, they had a video of an ARISS contact that failed on their first attempt. So it's still happening sort of today. And that's why they call it an experiment. And that's why NASA has the schools and the hams practice, practice, practice. But you can't account for everything. And we're done. ARISS is still going strong. Does your club have what it takes to be the telephone operators for an ARISS contact? I'll bet you do. That's it for this episode of Ham Radio Now. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ, an Epic production. Stop by hamradionow.tv, feed Arvin back there, our chief financial officer, if you've enjoyed the programs and got something out of it. And I am heading for Dayton. I am late. Got a lot of stuff to pack. It's Wednesday. I'm leaving early tomorrow morning. Got to finish editing this episode and then get in the car and go. I'll see you there. Over and out.